You know, to sit here on this stage, Richard Rodgers Theater, what does it mean to you?
They're hallowed places, these Broadway houses. Guys and Dolls premiered here. 1776 premiered here, when it was called the 46th Street Theater. I'm very aware of the ghosts. I'm very aware of the history that we, you know, like this earth, we only get to borrow it for a little while.
Yeah.
And, you know, my Broadway debut was on the stage, Within the Heights. It was amazing to do the show for the first time here and say, oh wait, I know this house. Yeah. I've been here before. But to be here with, the latest story I've spent my life working on, was really both disorienting and intimate. You know, the relationship with the crowd, as you can see, it's a steep rake. It's the steepest rake on Broadway. Yeah. I can look people in the eye.
Here.
14 rows back.
Right.
And paradoxically, even though the Theater at the Public was smaller, this feels more intimate to me.
Wow. And you had a chance to choose.
Yes.
Where you would
go. Yeah, this was our dream theater, and it luckily opened up sort of right before we came in.
Has it sunk in what's happening to you, what's happening to theater, what's happening to Hamilton?
I'm talking to Charlie Rose in the middle of the Richard Rodgers Theater, so it's starting to sink in. It's really surreal, but we really haven't stopped. The moment we opened, we started recording the cast album. And Atlantic has been very generous in terms of, we're taking 2 weeks to record it. Most cast albums get recorded in a day. And we took our time to really get it right. My colleagues are mastering it as we speak. So we've been going full bore. There's always been something to occupy our time. So I haven't really had a break since we opened.
And really haven't had time to reflect.
No, not really. That's also a part of what Twitter is. It's as close to a diary as, can you believe this happened?
Yes, that's right.
And catching it while it happens, because I'll be able
to. Or guess
to
look who was in
it.
The audience today?
Yeah, yeah.
The President of the United States.
At our sixth preview.
The Vice President of the United States.
Yes. It's amazing. It is amazing. Yes. It's, you know, you have the dream version of what will happen if you write something well, and this has. It's put my dreams to shame.
Exactly.
You dream too small.
Huge.
It really
beyond
is.
Dreams.
It's so
beyond
humbling.
Dreams.
Yeah. It's super, super humbling. And when you list those bold-faced names that have come to see the show, I see those as an opportunity to see the show with fresh eyes while I'm doing it.
Oh, yeah.
I think, when Dick Cheney is sitting in the audience, I think, what is he thinking when he hears the lyric history has its eyes on you?
Boy.
You know, when the president is here, what is he thinking as he sees George Washington say, I have to step down so the country can move on, as he faces the end of his term? It gives me a new chance at a new resonance with the show. And that's, you know, the challenge of doing.
Do you look them in the eye? Do you let them know, I see you?
If I can spot them. If I can spot them, I sure do.
Yeah.
You know, we had, who did we have? We had Common here. Common, one of my favorite rappers.
Oh, boy.
And when we started 10 Dual Commandments, I looked right at him. I said, someone's going to get this reference. It's going to be Common. You know, this thing's such a love letter to hip hop. When there's musical theater references, you know, We do a reference to a musical called The Last 5 Years by Jason Robert Brown. At the end of the Reynolds affair, he goes, nobody needs to know, which is the hook of the infidelity song in The Last 5 Years. And when Jason Robert Brown came to the show, I looked right at him. And you know, he kindly gave me his permission to use that song and that reference in the show. So it's a treat when the people who will appreciate it are in the audience.
But it's not only good acting, it is not only good music, people are saying it's transformative.
Well, that's interesting to me. It certainly changes my life.
Yeah.
But I think it's because when great people cross our path, and I'm talking about Hamilton here, it forces us to reckon with what we're doing with our lives. You know? At my age, Hamilton as Treasury Secretary and creating our financial system from scratch.
And building a country.
Yeah. I wrote two plays. I'm not doing anything.
Makes you feel.
It makes you feel like
this. Like a sand on the beach.
And we ask the question a lot in the show, who lives, who dies, who tells your story? Yeah. And what are we going to leave behind? And I think people leave the show thinking about that with their own lives. You can't help but let it into your own life.
It also makes people think about their history.
Yeah.
You know, their history.
Absolutely.
Their country.
Yeah.
You know, and it gives them a new sense of what? An awareness of the dynamism.
Yes. Well,
what's genius that came to build a nation.
The genius, but also, I think we take great pains to knock all these guys off their pedestals.
Yeah, you do.
You know, this is Washington impatient and yelling, are these the men with which I am to defend America? Which he did as he was fleeing New York. That's a quote. This is Jefferson and Hamilton squabbling. And I think we're heartened by that because these guys didn't get tablets in stone from on a mountaintop. They compromised. Yeah. They made mistakes. Yeah. Their fights led to precedents.
Right.
And I think it's an important reminder that they were as human as us and as flawed as us.
And they had no playbook.
Yeah, they had models that they were looking to.
Yeah. Well,
but
of course. Jefferson especially.
Yes.
Inspired by the French.
Inspired by the French and Hamilton inspired by the British financial system.
Yeah.
And so, and that turned in their fight. That turned into, you're trying to bring back the monarchy.
Yeah.
You know, you are obsessed with bloodshed and revolution. But it's nice to know they're flawed because our country's flawed and we're flawed. And we take steps forward and we take steps back towards that more perfect union, which is what a beautiful phrase that is.
And like writing great songs, it doesn't happen overnight.
No, so we're still struggling with it.
Yeah.
And I think the audience takes away a sense of, oh, we've always been making it up as we go along. And I think for them to see themselves in the Founding Fathers is both empowering and daunting. You're empowered because you're like, oh, this guy's just like me. Mm. But you also think, wow, look at what they got done. What am I getting done?
Why does it resonate? For all the reasons we talked about, but sitting out there, what are you feeling? Why does it touch you so much more than anything anybody else can think? Not just critics, not just famous people, real people.
Yeah, most of that is the work of Tommy Cale, who, you know, these are words on a page. There's a lot of steps.
Well, you put the words on the page.
I put the words on the page, but there's a lot of steps between the words on a page and a production like this.
Yeah.
And Tommy, you know, he has kept his eye on everything and created an unbelievably unified production where everyone's marching in the same direction and created those moments that we talked about where you're chasing that moment where you're both watching something and can't believe you're watching it. And Tommy created a bunch of those moments in this show. And he gets the credit for that because it's a lot of elements coming together to make that happen. And I think the force of Hamilton's life, which is this whirlwind through the life of everyone that he touched, now extends to the audience. Now he's touched your life too, and he's touched
Absolutely.
My life.
Everybody
and we see where he started and where he got and where he fell. And it's impossible not to be moved by that kind of a story. We all aspire to do great things.
Do you ever imagine what might have been if he hadn't taken that bullet?
Yeah, well, you know, you study the brain with world-renowned experts and you talk to scientists, so you know there is this theory of the multiverse, right? And there are an infinite number of universes sitting side by side. So there's a universe in which Hamilton lived to his 90s, and our country looked very different.
Why do you go on a vacation and stop and see a book that changes your life?
It's pretty lucky. And luck's a big part of this, too.
Yeah. Always is.
But I was at a bookstore.
Luck and timing.
Yeah. I wanted a big, long book. I knew that Hamilton, this is what I knew from high school. I knew Hamilton died in a duel with the vice president. I knew he was on the $10 bill. I knew his son had died in a duel. I wrote a school paper about it for 11th grade social studies. So I knew that he was I kind of wanted to know his mindset going into the duel. That's all I knew when I picked up the book. And I also, you know, read the incredible reviews for Ron's book on the back and inside. And I said, okay, well, this is going to be a good version of this story. But really, I just was browsing the biography section. It could have been Truman.
And as you read it, what happened?
I was thunderstruck. I had the notion, I got to the part where, you know, a hurricane destroys St. Croix, where Hamilton is living. He's an orphan at this point, and he is working as a clerk. And he writes a poem about the carnage that this hurricane has left on this island, and this poem gets him off the island.
It's his ticket.
People say, this is a talented young man, and he shouldn't be a clerk. He should be going to get his degree in medicine, actually. They said, go get your degree in medicine, come back and be a doctor. And took up a collection to send him to the mainland. And the world was never the same.
So he had even then a sense after that, people believed in him. He had captured the confidence of people.
Yes.
And at a very young age.
Yes. The first letter we have from Hamilton is a letter to a friend named Ned Stevens. And he says, I know it may be said that I am building castles in the air. He's ashamed of his own ambition. And he said, and I pray you'll conceal it. But we have seen such schemes successful when the projector is constant. I shall conclude by saying that I wish there was a war. So we get all of his ambition in two sentences, right? I know it's crazy that I want to get out of here and I want to build a better life. But it's worked for people before and it could work for me if I don't stop, if the projector is constant. I shall conclude by saying I wish there was a war, which means I'm broke. I need to fight in a war in order to make my bones and gain myself a reputation.
And have the life I want to have.
And have the life I want to have.
The idea of hip-hop came at what moment?
When he wrote that poem and got himself off the
island.
That's
when.
Yeah.
You saw that in him.
Yes.
You saw a rap artist in him.
I drew a direct line between Hamilton's writing his way out of his circumstances and the rappers I'd grown up adoring.
They wrote themselves out of circumstances.
Yes, but they also wrote about their circumstances, which is what Hamilton did. You know, it's Lil Wayne writing about Katrina and the government not doing enough. It's Biggie and Jay-Z writing about growing up in the Marcy Projects in Brooklyn. It's Eminem writing about growing up white in Detroit. It's writing about that struggle, and paradoxically, your writing being so good, it gets you out.
So when you read that and you learned about Hamilton, you just...
Yeah. Yeah, you know...
You know, deep inside of me is the form that he would have.
Right. And also, you know, in the introduction to the book, you realize Hamilton wrote his way to everything.
Yeah.
His writing was the key to everything.
You finished the book during vacation?
Yep.
And you had to meet the author.
I did. I wanted to talk about this guy with him. I felt like I had such a clear picture of who Hamilton was when I finished reading that book that I wanted to talk to Ron and say, hey, we're seeing the same guy here, right?
Was this whole thing that we see every night, six nights a week, on this stage, what was already germinating when you went to talk to Ron?
Yes, it was starting to. I was thinking of it as an album first. But even that was a musical theater precedent because I was thinking about Jesus Christ Superstar and how Jesus Christ Superstar began as a concept album.
Right.
And Andrew Lloyd Webber wrote these amazing songs about the last 3 days of Jesus' life, and they were so good, they were like, you have to turn this into a show. And that's what I was hoping to do with Hamilton. I was going to make the album first, and then it just turned into a show.
All of this is going on in your head, all these possibilities. I mean, these characters.
These characters.
These times.
Yeah. The hard part was I needed to do enough research to really be able to write about it well. And that's what historians learn. You've got to, you know, you can't just go with the story that's in front of you. You got to go check your sources and you got to go.
So you dived into research.
I did. Not just about Hamilton. You know, Ron's book was a great guide for that, but research into Burr, research into Jefferson. And finding little things that were their insight. And so I'm looking for the historical versions of those moments for my characters as I'm writing them. So for me, unlocking Burr, there's a great biography by H.W. Brand called The Heartbreak of Aaron Burr.
Right.
It's about his relationship with his wife and daughter. Slim volume. The other thing I learned was when he met his wife, she was married to a British officer. She was helping the revolutionaries. They were staying in her house, and he kind of stayed in touch with her. And their correspondence was like a year before her husband died in Georgia. And then as soon as he died, like, they were together.
Burr was there.
Yeah. So this is a guy who waited for this officer to die before he could properly. So I was like, okay, this guy is comfortable waiting for his moment. Yeah. That was the key insight for me. I was like, oh, wow. Even in matters of love, I understood that he was politically cautious. But even when it came to matters of his own heart, he said, all right, this woman's the woman for me. I'm going to wait to see what happens. Circumstances will just work out.
That's the kind of patience many people don't have.
Yeah. Yeah, and in our show, Hamilton calls him out. If you love this woman, go get her. Yeah. Go fight for her. Go
That's what I would do.
That's what I would do. Yeah. And Burr says, no, I'm going to wait. It'll come to me.
And Burr becomes your narrator.
Yes.
Because you need what?
I need several things. I need, I need balance. Hamilton would be happy to narrate his own story, but he goes on too long.
Yeah, in paragraphs and paragraphs.
Burr has license to be succinct. And also, Burr is the mirror image of Hamilton. He's also orphaned at a young age. Yeah. He's also speeds through college, speeds through Princeton in 2 years. Starts at 13, age 13. And
just as smart as Hamilton?
Just as smart as Hamilton. But every time Hamilton says go, Burr says stop. He's just cautious. The only difference between them is legacy. Burr came from money. Burr's father was the president of Princeton. Burr's grandfather was the famous preacher, Jonathan Edwards. And he's got all this legacy, and he doesn't know what to do with it, in my version of him. And so he's very cautious. He's got money. He's in the firmament of early American aristocracy.
So when you got excited about Hamilton, though, you did not necessarily know that much more about Burr.
No, I had to go looking for Burr.
That's a treasure, because he's everything that you need dramatic tension.
Yes, but it's tough because it's not linear, you know? Hamilton's public squabbles were with Jefferson.
Yeah.
You know, most people would say, well, Jefferson's the bad guy and Jefferson should narrate, because those were the political fights. The fight with Burr is one of temperament. So how do you dramatize a difference in temperament? You know, I have a friend who gets mad about everything, but our lives, you know. So I had to find that very internal thing and figure out how to dramatize it and sort of always show Hamilton going and always show Burr pausing. And that was very tricky.
I want to talk about these characters.
Yeah.
First of all, they're Latino.
They're everything.
They're everything.
They're everything. Pippa Sue, who plays my wife, is Chinese American.
And that's on purpose.
That they're everything? Yes.
Yeah.
It's Tommy said it so well that I just quote him. This is the story of America then, told by America now.
That's a great line.
And it's
story of America then, told by America now.
That's right.
You're and America now.
We're America now. And this is what this country looks like. This is what our country looks like. Simple as that. So we're allowed to tell the story, because it's the story of our country, too.
What do you think it means to your actors?
I've been told what it means to our actors.
You know your actors, for God's sakes.
I'm with them every night. it's very moving. You know, some of these actors I've known my entire adulthood. Some of these actors I just met when they auditioned for the show. And, you know, Chris Jackson and I, Chris plays George Washington. Right. He's as much a history buff as I am, if not more so. We're both West Wing fanatics. So he both knew and was daunted by stepping into George Washington's shoes, because he knew everything that meant and everything that represented. He'd done his homework. He's read Chernow's biography of Washington 3 or 4 times. It's a big book. It was interesting talking to David, who said, I didn't know any of this. David plays Jefferson.
I know.
I never felt like any of those stories were relevant to my life and my upbringing. We grew up you know, we've all grown up in the sort of descendants of this legacy of slavery, and we think, well, those are our narratives and that's our story. But the story of the creation of this country is our story too.
So what were you looking for in casting all these, you and Tommy?
People who could do it. That sounds simple, but it's hard.
But the why?
Because it's a ton of language. It's easier for you to do this show if you've maybe done a little Shakespeare, maybe done a little Chekhov, than if you've done three musicals.
Yeah.
Because of the sheer abundance of language in the piece. And so
it is Shakespearean in terms of how much you can
get. In terms
get
of quality,
into 2 hours.
Not in terms of quality. In terms of quantity.
Quantity within time.
Yeah, and density. These are packed sentences.
So you had to have somebody that could deliver.
Deliver and make it feel real and to a beat. Mm. And that's hard.
That's musical talent.
That's musical talent, and it requires a level of. A degree of expertise in terms of acting craft to make this feel spontaneous, because it is such heightened language.
Costumes is another thing.
Absolutely.
How did you conceive that?
I didn't.
Okay.
Our genius, Paul Tazewell, did.
Okay, well, how did he conceive it?
He had a lot of conversations with Tommy Kail, and Tommy said, well, my nightmare version of this, and he'll speak to this, my nightmare version of this is sideways baseball caps and high tops and saying, yo, we're the president.
Yeah.
You know, that's an outdated version of hip hop that the mass market still likes to circulate as being hip hop. He said, it's much more interesting to create the tension between a period costume and contemporary language. And so they went
the
full
tension
period.
Between a period costume and contemporary language.
Contemporary language.
The tension.
Yes. That tension is compelling and it's exciting. It's exciting to see someone dressed in a period-specific Revolutionary War outfit rapping faster than anybody. We're asking you to hold a lot of ideas in your head at the same time, and we are hopefully creating a unified aesthetic that that allows you to get it all and just let it all hang together of a piece.
But there are also in this piece references to South Pacific.
Uh-huh. South Pacific. Forum.
Pirates of Penzance?
Pirates of Penzance.
So what's that about other than your brain?
There's a lot of on-ramps in the show. That's Tommy's line too. There's a lot of on-ramps. There's a lot of ways in, right? If you're scared of hip hop or you thought hip hop was not music for you, we're gonna quote 1776 at you. We're gonna quote South Pacific at you. We're gonna give you King George, who sings a British invasion style song from the 60s.
That's a showstopper too.
It's a showstopper and it's a breath. It's a breath where the lyrics slow down and we take our time. And it's to show we know how to write that kind of song. Yeah. We're writing this kind of song.
Is it written with comedy in mind?
Absolutely. Yeah, I with King George, I was thinking of King Herod and Jesus Christ Superstar. I was thinking of the Thénardiers, who provide much needed comic relief in Les Miserables. Without them, it's a tough piece. And it's also, what's interesting about that role, and I didn't even really anticipate it when I was writing it, the king becomes the audience's surrogate. As they watch this country being formed in front of their eyes, and the king goes, wait, you're really gonna keep changing leaders? Yeah. Wait, what are you gonna do now that the war is over?
Or are you gonna come back?
Oh, you'll be back. he speaks to the country as if it was a girlfriend he didn't treat well. And it's really fun to watch the audience take his side.
What's your creative process? Where are you when you write all this?
And
what are you doing?
What am I doing?
You're just sitting in an empty room.
No, I'm never sitting in an empty room.
Where are you?
I'm sitting in a room, usually a cluttered desk, with a keyboard hooked up to my computer. And often what I did with this show is I'd write just enough music to get a loop. Yeah. I'd get a loop of a beat that I like, or, you know, a four chord progression that I like. If I like it enough, sync it up to my iPod, take my dog out for a walk.
And listen.
And I listen to that thing on a loop and I talk to myself in the park. And my dog is super patient, doesn't care that I'm talking to myself in the park. People think I'm crazy. It's fine by me.
Yeah.
And I talk to myself in the character, in the form of the character. This is after I've done the research and I know what the song needs to accomplish. I just talk to myself until it starts to fit.
Central question, Alexander Hamilton, which you knew about, is dueling.
Yeah.
Tell me about Hamilton, though, and going into this.
Yeah.
I mean, he had a lunch date.
Yeah.
It's early in the morning.
It's dawn. It's dawn. They row across to Weehawken at dawn.
Why do you think he threw away his shot? Why do you think? And do you believe that, or is it simply something that makes your play?
What I came to was, I'm less interested in the who did what, as I am, what were Hamilton's final thoughts? What was going through his head, faced with his once friend, now enemy? We're on a field, the sun is rising over Manhattan.
In New Jersey.
Yeah, the sun is rising over Manhattan, and we've got guns in our hands, and we're facing each other in a field. What did he think about in those final moments? I think he's probably thinking about the steps that got him here and his disagreements with Burr. He writes in a letter before the duel, he said, there was no way this could have been avoided. We've been circling each other for a while. It was always going to come to this. And that was a big clue, was, oh, his disagreements with Burr are not the choice of words at a dinner
this
party.
This was going to happen.
This was going to happen. They're fundamentally different men.
Does he sing that?
Yeah. And well,
does he ever say, this was going to happen? I was coming to this moment.
And I have him say it when he's 19 and gets to New York, and I have him say it again in his final moments. I imagine death so much it feels more like a memory.
Yeah.
This is where it gets me. On my feet, several feet ahead of me. If I see it coming, do I run or fire my gun or let it be? There is no beat, no melody. You know, I have him thinking about what those final moments are because he's aware of it as a young child. And so when it finally comes, it's actually quiet. It's actually our only moment of quiet in the show. It's the only time we don't have a beat going, the only time we don't have any instruments. All you hear is a little wind. Mm-hmm. And it's Hamilton alone with his thoughts as this bullet is coming towards him. And it's the last thing I wrote for the show. I've been writing song moment after song moment, like what does it sound like? What is the song? I'd written a draft called In the Time It Takes the Bullet to Leave the Gun, and it was very exciting. And then I said, we've actually earned silence.
Yeah, I like it better.
Yeah, yeah, I like it better too.
Because it is the moment.
Yeah, it's the moment, and I think that's what we hear. In those final moments, we hear silence.
And his last words were?
I don't remember his last words. No. Ronald, no. But he died with his whole family by his side. It took him a day to die. And Angelica was there. She was in New York at the time. Eliza was there. His children were there wailing.
Wailing?
Yes. He died at a friend's house on Maiden Lane.
How long after the bullet entered him?
About 24 hours after. So he suffered and died slow.
Can I just talk about, I mean, it's just powerful. The songs. Do you have favorites? Are those that, if you got to say, I just wrote this.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you the creation of one of, you know, sometimes a line enters your head and you're so grateful for it. You go online to check to see if anyone wrote it before you. You must have stolen it.
Yes, yes.
That was true of Burr's song, Wait For It, which the hook came to me of a piece. I was on my way to a friend's birthday party in Brooklyn, and I was listening to my loop on the train, and it came to me, death doesn't discriminate between the sinners and the saints. It takes and it takes and it takes. We keep living anyway. We rise and we fall and we break and we make our mistakes. And if there's a reason I'm still alive when everyone who loves me has died, I'm willing to wait for it. That came in one giant lump on a train to Brooklyn. And I went to my friend's party and I said, happy birthday, I have to go home and finish writing this song. And I got back on the train and wrote it on the way home. Couldn't wait, couldn't wait.
How about Room Where It Happens?
Room Where It Happens was the toughest jigsaw puzzle I've ever done. I'm both trying to explain this very complicated compromise that happened behind closed doors. And what makes it exciting in the context of our story is we're telling it from the perspective of the one guy who wasn't there, Aaron Burr. He says, these guys just traded away the capital of our country in exchange for an unprecedented financial plan. And it all happened over a dinner that none of us were at. None of us had any say in the decision.
The room where it happens.
And so it's Rashomon. It's Jefferson's side of the story. Yeah. It's Madison's side of the story. Madison's in Congress, and everyone's like, the Capitol should be here. And he's saying, and he says to Jefferson in our song, maybe we can solve one problem with another and win a victory for the Southerners. In other words, oh ho, Jefferson's, wouldn't you like to work a little closer to home?
Yes.
So yeah. It's two Virginians plotting on how to get the Capitol closer to where they're at.
To Washington rather than New York.
Yeah. Washington doesn't exist yet.
I know.
To the Potomac.
Virginia.
Yeah.
Other songs there? I mean, what is it you want us, what is it that you think will be most remembered?
I can't begin to pretend to know. I know that...
The opening number.
The opening number, I was very proud of having written that song and what it captured.
Satisfied, we said.
Wait for it was a big one for me because that hook is Burr's, but that's how I feel. that hook's pretty odd. You know, we don't know why some of us live and some of us die, and why some of us are born, but are lucky enough to be born where we are and have access to healthcare and incredible life, and some of us are born in parts of the world where none of that is guaranteed. And if there's a reason, is there a reason why we're born where we are or grow up where we are? And if there is a reason, Burr says, I'm gonna wait for what that reason is to present itself. And Hamilton says, nothing's promised. I'm gonna grab everything I can while I can.
Are you Burr or are you Hamilton?
I'm both. We're all both. That's the whole thing. I think that there are moments in our life when we step up and we take the risk when it's easier to stay home. You know, you go sing 16 bars of Hamilton at the White House when you could have sung a song you already know. That's the Hamilton in me. It took me 6 years to get the show to Broadway. That's the Burr in me.
It took you that long to get it right.
Yeah. Yeah.
To get it right.
And we could have moved to Broadway last season.
Yeah.
But we didn't. We knew we had another chance to make the show better. And that's what we were aiming for, to make the best show possible. And so that's the wait for it. That's the Burr.
In a moment of self-definition, are you writer?
Yes. You don't have to finish that. I'm a writer. I'm an actor to get my writing done. I see writing and acting as the same thing. I have to inhabit those characters and play them as fully as I can, then I write down what they say. That's as simple as it is and as complicated as it is.
And the genius is writing. Don't be afraid of the word, just...
Here's the thing. If you write about geniuses, they confuse you with one. That's how I feel about Hamilton. I'm writing about a genius. Don't get it twisted. I'm no genius, but I'm writing, and I have to write from his perspective, so it looks close to the same thing, but it's not.